Penguin Random House Audio presents The Lazy Genius Way. Embrace what matters, ditch what doesn't, and get stuff done. With a foreword written and read by Emily P. Freeman. This is the author, Kendra Adachi.
Foreword. Some moments, such as weddings, births, graduations, and proposals, carve a deep groove in our memories because they mark our lives in a significant way. Other moments remain embedded in time because they hold hands with deep emotions like joy, shock, passion, or grief. Still, life is mostly made up of the kinds of moments that may seem ordinary while you live them, but are the ones you return to in gratitude. It's not because they were necessarily remarkable, but because they shaped the contours of your life one small moment at a time. In the spring of 2008, my husband John and I were in the middle of packing up all our worldly belongings to move to a house across town. In addition to the regular stress that accompanies moving, John was about a year into a new job at a local church, and we had three children, ages 4 and under. It seemed every area of our life was touched by either chaos or transition, and I was weeks past ready for both to be over. A few days before the closing, all our furniture was at the new house, but we still had some last-minute items we needed to pack up in the old one: condiments in the fridge, stacks of junk mail on the counter, plastic bins with no lids in the dining room, and a few final kitchen drawers filled with misfit office supplies, tangled wires, and unidentifiable gadget leftovers. As it turns out, you don't just get to move with the stuff you like. You have to move with everything. I was ready to set the remaining items on fire so we didn't have to pack or unpack them. But instead of lighting a match, I called a friend. While John stayed with our kids at the new house, my friend came to help me empty the old house of those few straggling possessions and load my car one last time. If you've been alive for 5 minutes, maybe you already know this was a fairly vulnerable ask. I had known this friend for only about a year at this point, and I was shy about asking her over for dinner, much less inviting her to help me transport the dregs of our life from our old house to our new one. She would see my obvious disorganization and the unnecessary junk I held on to. Moreover, she would see me in all my frazzled, unshowered, end-of-my-rope glory. Still, she came. We worked together in silence, carrying lidless plastic containers filled with random tools, freezer items, and light bulbs out to the yard to load into our cars. I remember feeling relief that she didn't wait for my direction, which honestly, at that point, would have probably been to point to the yard and hand her a match. Instead, she saw what needed doing, and she worked quickly, without commentary, helping me finish up the last embarrassing loads and get the job done. What I remember most about that day was her kind silence and her present posture. If you haven't figured it out yet, that friend was Kendra Adachi. And though that move was more than 10 years ago, though that afternoon was not accompanied by a single meaningful conversation or a traditionally significant moment, the memory revisits me often, and I tear up thinking of it even now. Because instead of approaching that move like a lazy genius, I handled it more like an overworked fool. I did the wrong things in the wrong order, feeling shame for the state of my house and the chaos in my life. Meanwhile, Kendra is an expert at creating systems to finish tasks. She's a master at doing the right things in the right order for the right reasons, from packing a box to hosting a party. While it was, of course, a gift to have a friend willing to help me move and to be able to trust a friend to see me at my frantic worst, the reason this memory stands out for me goes even deeper than that. It stands out because the thing I felt I was failing so miserably at was the very thing she was so good at. And still, she showed up for me, filled with compassion, miles from judgment. She showed up for me in love. The book you're now listening to is evidence of that love. You may have picked it up because you need help getting stuff done. She will certainly help you do that. But efficient systems fail to deliver if they're implemented without kindness. That's the unique gift of this book and why I'm so grateful to Kendra for finally writing it down. The reason the Lazy Genius Way has the potential to change how you live your life is not simply because of its practical tips, but because of the spirit in which they're offered. From the way you clean your kitchen to the way you start your day, being a lazy genius is not about doing things the right way, but about finally finding your own way. You won't hear empty mantras shaming you into doing things better. Instead, you'll be encouraged to decide what matters for you, and you'll receive permission to gently leave the rest behind. It's been 10 years since my family moved. Since then, Kendra and I have shared countless moments together, and I no longer feel any shadow of embarrassment when she sees me at my rock bottom worst. This transformation started the day she showed up ready to help me, even though she could have bossed me into ways of doing it better. But she didn't shame me then, and she won't shame you either. Kendra is teaching me to be a genius about the things that matter and lazy about the things that don't. Before you give up on yourself and allow chaos to tempt you to burn the house down, back away from the matches and listen to this kind, life-giving, practical book. Emily P. Freeman, author of The Next Right Thing.
Introduction. Please don't skip it. I'm not a mom who plays. I mean, I will, but I personally don't like knocking down a stack of blocks 20,000 times in a row, no matter how much joy it brings my kids. I have three, by the way. Sam is in fourth grade and obsessed with Minecraft. Ben is in second grade and obsessed with painting the Mona Lisa. And Annie is in preschool and obsessed with me. Thankfully, my husband is a dad who plays. A few summers ago, he came up big while we were vacationing at the beach. He dug an impressive hole in the sand, a hole so deep you had to lean over the edge to see the bottom. Then, with the enthusiasm of a carnival showman, he got all three kids to race back and forth from the ocean, carrying buckets of water to fill the hole as quickly as they could. Over and over again, they hauled and poured, but that hole would not fill up. Every single drop soaked back into the sand, taunting them in their efforts. Because my kids are adorable little weirdos, they thought it was fun and played the game for a long while. That is, until a flock of aggressive seagulls became more interesting. As they ran off to chase the birds, I saw the discarded buckets surrounding the empty hole and realized I was looking at a metaphor of my life. Maybe it's one for yours too. Here's what we do as women. If you're a dude, please let this inform your understanding of how women are often wired and the pressures we feel due to the culture we're a part of. Also, thank you for reading this book, even though I will unashamedly always use female pronouns. As women, we pick our spot in the sand to dig a hole, checking to see if the women around us are choosing similar or, gulp, better spots, trying not to be distracted by their motherly patience and bikini bodies. We start digging, hoping the hole is deep enough and headed in the right direction. Where is it going? No idea. But who cares? Everyone else is digging, so we dig too. Eventually, it's time to start hauling buckets to fill the hole. We carry load after load of water, color-coded calendars, room mom responsibilities, meal plans, and work-life balance. We haul, we try, we sweat, and we watch that hole stay empty. Now we're confused.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.